Good morning to our student and to anybody who is attending this presentation. I'm very grateful to the student generale for the opportunity given to share with you my knowledge and experience on the topic of innovation through tradition. So I will now switch to the presentation mode and we will start our journey together. As you read in this slide, the topic of this presentation is innovation through tradition in the family business. I'm Alfredo De Massis. I'm a full professor of entrepreneurship and family business at the Free University of Bolzano and the director of the UniBiz Center for Family Business Management, which is located at the Noi Tech Park. Most of what I'm going to tell you is based on my research, and my research, which means, you know, that some of the things I will tell you have been published in the leading academic journals in management or entrepreneurship, such as this article on innovation to tradition published in the Academy of Management Perspective, or a most recent one on managing the tradition and innovation paradox appeared in Entrepreneurship Theory and Practice. But other of the outlet where I publish my work are more practice-oriented outlets, such as Il Sole 24 Ore in Italy or Sistemi Impresa, and this perfectly exposes my philosophy and my identity as a scholar. Indeed, I strongly believe in engaged scholarship, which means that my research is academically rigorous, of course, but I also pay special attention to the impact for practice of my activities. And I will start this journey on the topic of innovation to tradition with you by discussing a typical paradox that very often I see when I interact with family business leaders and owners, and that characterizes the innovation activities of family firms, which is what, in some of my studies, I call the ability and willingness paradox in family firm innovation. This is, for example, the title of this article that we published on the Journal of Product Innovation Management, which is the leading journal in innovation management. So when we consider innovation in the context of a family firms, very often such companies face a paradox. And I think the easiest way to understand this paradox is through the words of Niccolò Pellini, who is the third generation owner at Pellini Cafe in Italy, Verona, who, during one of the many conversations we had together, told me, "It's really frustrating to be recognized for our ability to handle complex innovation projects and realizing that our organizational environment reduces disposition to change." Well, behind this line, what is kind of clear is that there is a kind of tension, because on the one hand, he says, okay, we are a perfect environment in terms of ability to conduct innovation. Indeed, there are a number of theoretical reasons arguing for the fact that family firms are better able to innovate, for example, because the family typically speaks the same languages, because the family has the power or the discretion to quickly execute decisions when these are made, etc., etc. But at the same time, they are characterized by a lower willingness to innovate. Indeed, Niccolò Pellini says, realizing the tower organizational environment reduces disposition to change. And this is what we argue to be a very typical paradox in family business innovation. Because family firms, for a number of reasons, due to their characteristics, will be better able to innovate, yet they are less willing to do so, and so they get stuck. So this is an important starting point. Often, innovation in the context of family firms is particularly difficult. And it also tells to consultants, to family business leaders, to family business experts, that if you want to really unlock the innovation potential of a family enterprise, you don't have too much to work on the ability sides, but on the willingness sides, which means that you have to work more on the psychological factors that, you know, lead them to be reluctant to innovate. Well, one of the ways to resolve this paradox, or at least to manage it, is innovation. So let me introduce very briefly tradition in the context of a family firm. Because, of course, the family business is an ideal context for tradition. Indeed, there are studies showing that the values and beliefs of the founding family in a family firm are handed down from generation to generation. There are studies by myself and some other colleagues showing that the family firm is a kind of organizational, is a type of organizational setting where the organizational culture and identity closely reflects the way the firm has operated in the past. There are other studies by other colleagues and myself showing that family history pervades business practices, creating a cross link between the families and the firm's tradition. So in the family business, tradition is particularly lively and particularly present and strong typically. Now, if we consider the innovation management literature, in the innovation management literature, unfortunately, so far, very often, too often, the past, the tradition, is depicted, is portrayed as something that causes power dependence, that causes inertia, that causes inflexibility. The past is always often depicted as a source of resistance to change, as an organizational excuse to perpetuate the status quo. There are scholars talking about liability of senescence, for example. So, in generally speaking, the innovation management literature, which is a literature that unfortunately until a decade ago, when I and some other colleagues started working on innovation in the context of family firms, has largely overlooked family firms, focusing on other types of business enterprises. But this literature, if you read all this vast literature, the key simple message emerging from managers is, if you want to make the way for the future, just forget, dismiss about the past, forget about your past. And so when we started working on the topic of innovation through tradition, we started by a very simple consideration, which is that probably such approach, so the approach consisting in dismissing the past in order to make the way for the future, can be inadequate or even counterproductive in family firms, where tradition is very strong, and that are a kind of business enterprise that any kind of other business need to innovate. And our research actually suggests that tradition may represent a powerful and unique source of competitive advantage for innovation. So what we basically argue in another article is that if you, as a business, as a company, pay too much attention on the most recent knowledge and forget about your past knowledge, about the type of knowledge that is more temporally distant, you risk to have what we call a recency bias. A recency bias means that by giving excessive weight to the most recent knowledge, firms risk to overlook the potential benefit of all knowledge. And I have reported here some examples, very briefly. You know, this is here on the right, to UU. She was awarded the Nobel Prize for Medicine without having a medical background, a doctorate in medicine. And she did it just because rather than following the typical trajectory of scientific progress, she basically understood by looking at some ancient books and some ancient knowledge that some herbs could be used to treat some disease like malaria. And due to that kind of very temporary distant knowledge, she was able to introduce and develop a new medicines that can be used to treat malaria. And this is another case, Polaroid. You know, Polaroid was a company that was very famous in the 70s and the 80s for leading kind of one of the leaders in the instant cameras business. At some point, they decided to kind of start of dismissing their old knowledge in instant cameras to embrace more digital knowledge. And only when they came back with the campaign Instant is Back that recombines this old knowledge with the new knowledge, they started, you know, flourishing again. So these examples, and I have many more, illustrate that by giving excessive weight to the most recent knowledge, firms risk to overlook the potential benefits of the old knowledge. So what do we mean by old knowledge, by tradition? Well, this is how we define tradition in our study. Tradition refers to the stock of knowledge, competences, materials, manufacturing processes, product science, values and beliefs belonging, pertaining to the past. So tradition can be related to some tangible things like raw materials, for example, but also to some more intangible things such as the values and beliefs of the family and in the business. for example, or the product signs. Product signs are combinations of colors and text that examples is the Missoni sweater, the Missoni sweater that we have here. I mean, you can really see the tradition of the family and of the business in their new product. So tradition, you know, if we agree on this definition, means that it has to do with the know-how, with the symbolic and cultural content, and also with the micro-institutional practices that are handed down in a family company from generation to the next. And what is important is that tradition shapes the identity of individuals, of organizations, and of the territories where such organizations operate. And as I said, you know, can be very valuable from a strategy point of view. You know, in strategy, when you discuss about value, you typically distinguish between value creation and value capture. Now, if you are able as a company to embed in your new products your own tradition or the tradition of the territory where you operate, you are likely to achieve advantages both in terms of value creation and in terms of value capture. In terms of value creations, there are theories in psychology, sociology, arguing that each of us look with very positive feelings the golden age of the past. So tradition is likely to elicit strong and positive feeling in the customers. Moreover, if you are able as a company to embed the tradition into your new products, this is also likely to increase the legitimacy and the reliability of the new products. Let's not forget that when a company brings to the market, on the market, a new product, consumer can be skeptical because this is new. And so, you know, tradition brings some advantages also in terms of increasing legitimacy and increasing reliability. A second advantage is in terms of value capture, because the tradition is idiosyncratic to yourself as a company. So it cannot be easily replicated by others. And so if you are able to embed the tradition in your company, you know, it will be more difficult for competitors to imitate. And so there are both advantages in terms of value creation and in terms of value capture. Now I will show you some of the companies I've been working with and I've been closely studying in my research on innovation to tradition. This is one of them. It's Aboca. It's a company founded in 1978. It's the second generation. It's located in Sansepolcro in Tuscany. I think it has a turnover which is roughly around 125 million euros, or at least this was the data when we interviewed them, and it employs around 810 employees. This is a company in the biotech industry. It's a pharmaceutical company, but it produces medicines basically using natural herbs, and specifically, most of the natural herbs of the territories where the company operates. And their innovation process starts in environments like this that you see depicted at the top of this slide, where they basically start buying all these ancient books, sometimes written in, you know, ancient strange languages, and they have people with backgrounds like in humanities, philologies, etc., and they start codifying this knowledge before, you know, they enter the later stage of the innovation process. This is another company we studied. It's located in southern Italy, Apri a Mare. It was founded in 1949 by Giovanni Aprea. It's a fifth generation, and they had revenues of around 20 million euros with 185 employees, again, if I'm not wrong. And they were able to transform the Gozzo Sorrentino, that was a typical boat for fishermen, into a private luxury boat, you know, for a private kind of market target. Another one very well known is Beretta. Beretta is founded in 1526. It's a 15th generation family company. Many of us know this company. It's based in Cardone Valtrompia in the province of Brescia. It employs roughly 850 people, and their revenues at the time when we started them were around 480 million euros. This is a company, you know, where the craftsmanship heritage is reinterpreted into innovative petition shotguns. For example, the A400 XL is one of their innovations. And you can see, you know, even from this photo, how there is a kind of blending of new technology with more traditional techniques, which in this case refer not only to the raw materials, they use only the raw materials that have been traditionally used in their radars, but also, you know, in terms of manufacturing process and also in terms of a number of more intangible aspects. This is another very interesting company, Vibram. It's a company founded in 1937 by Vitale Bramani. It's, I think, is the second generation, located in Amizzate in Varese, and employs, roughly speaking, 240 employees. The innovation that we started, one of the innovation that we started in this company is this five-finger shoes. These are shoes that, you know, if you wear these shoes, it's almost like walking barefoot. And in this case, if you talk with this family, you understand that there is a kind of overarching belief in this family, which is the belief that the human being can achieve a true fulfillment, a complete fulfillment, only and it was this kind of value or belief that drove this organization toward, you know, developing, for example, this kind of innovation. This family was also supporting, they were also supporters of the barefoot movement. Another example is Lavazza. Again, we also all known them, based in Turin in Northern Italy. They have around 3,000 employees. It's a fourth generation family company founded in 1895. And here, for example, we started the Coffee for Astronauts, which is the coffee that Samantha Cristoforetti had during admissions in the space. This is a coffee that can be taken, can be enjoyed in extreme condition, and yet maintains the same traditional features in terms of taste and everything else of the normal one. And it was, they achieved this innovation by recombining new technologies with the traditional coffee blending techniques, typically of the Lavazza family. Another interesting smaller size company is Sangalli, based in Milan. Here, you know, this is a company in the Milanese traditional sewing industry. So it's a very traditional company where tradition is very strong alive. For example, they use manual sewing machines, and they have also some very traditional processes to execute their activities, but also to teach, to educate, to teach, and to hand over the secrets behind these activities to the new generation, to the next generation. And one of the innovation that I reported here in these slides in terms of photo is this innovation by Federico Sangalli, who is the current leader in this company, who basically recombine traditional textures and traditional techniques to produce clothes and accessories according to the Sartoria Milanese with LED LED fiber optics to create a line of accessories and clothes that enlighten. So these are, you know, just some examples. Of course, we are working on this topic since a long time, and we have many more. And some of these also refer to service companies, not only to product companies. But these are all examples of companies that show that in the real world, you know, a family business can be at the same time very much innovative and very much anchored to its own tradition. And so the basic question that we ask ourselves is, how can a family business do that? And I will try to use this slide to reveal what we learn from these companies. This is again a slide that I extracted from this publication published in the Academy of Management Perspective, and is a paper titled Innovation to Tradition, Lessons from Innovative Family Businesses and Direction for Future Research. And there will be, I've added to this presentation a Dropbox link from which you can download this article and the others I published on the topic for those of you who might be interested to go a little bit more in depth on this topic. So, but what did we learn? I mean, here you have visualized a schematic representation of how this ITT, Innovation to Transition strategy, worked. What we learned is basically that these companies that are able to execute an ITT strategy are companies that are characterized by two main capabilities that we call interiorization and reinterpretation. Interiorizations means that these companies that, you know, uses the source, some sources of past knowledge, which can be the tradition of the firm or the tradition of the territory where the firm operates, these companies are very good at interiorizing these sources of past knowledge, meaning that they are very good at bringing this past knowledge very proximate, very close to everyone within their organization, from the higher ranked senior executive to the lower employees. And they are very good at making sure that everyone understands this past knowledge and it's very close to it. Then once this past knowledge has been interiorized, you know, the sources of past knowledge are kind of codified into forms of past knowledge, which in the case of some companies, for example, you know, Beretta, take more the form of codified knowledge, like raw materials, like manufacturing process. In the case of other companies, like, for example, in the case of Vibram, takes more the form of the tacit knowledge, so the basic assumptions and beliefs of the families. And then the second is what we call reinterpretation. So they are very good at reinterpreting these forms of past knowledge in the light of the current context, recombining all the new knowledge, all the new technologies were needed to produce new products that can be new, that are new, either because they are, you know, products that incorporate new functionalities, such as in the case, for example, of the Beretta shotgun, or they are new because these are products that have a new meaning for the customer. The functionalities are the same, but change the meaning for the customer. For example, in the case of the Vibram shoes, you know, it's still a shoe, yet the customer buys it because it conveys a new meaning for him. And this is an example of how this innovation to tradition works in one of those companies, the one in the pharmaceutical industry that I mentioned before. You know, this company has its own innovation to tradition process articulated across four main stages that we call recovery, revival, recombination, and remaking. Without entering into, you know, the details of these four stages, what I think is interesting here is to look at the fact that this company, you know, uses codified past knowledge resources and tacit past knowledge resources strategically in order to execute this ITT strategy. Indeed, they have a biblioteca antica, so a library, they have an historical museum, and they also have crafted a very systematic historical database. So these are examples of codified past knowledge resources that the company is using in order, you know, to realize this ITT strategy. At the same time, this company uses evocative artifacts and values and beliefs. So if you walk through the corridors of this company, you will see some artifacts, you will see some values and beliefs hanging on the wall. So they make use of tacit past knowledge resources in order to realize their innovation to tradition strategy. And, you know, in the next slide here, we find some of the practices. So what is it? Clear is that all the companies doing ITTs are companies that pay special attention to the past, to not to forget such past, such knowledge, such heritage, such tradition. These are companies, I told you before, that are endowed with two distinctive capabilities that are interiorization and reinterpretation. Now, also, you know, these are companies that, in terms of practices, carry out a number of practices that allow them to keep this tradition, this history very much alive. And I have grouped such practices into four main categories. I will briefly go through each of them. So one category of practices refers to historical narratives. So these are companies that are very good at doing, you know, internal and external storytelling about their heritage. So these are companies that really are very good at telling the story and making sure that you don't forget about your heritage and your own tradition. The second category of practices is what I call your ancestor symbolization. Ancestor symbolization refers to the use of symbols and visual objects that call to mind the heritage. So these are companies that, for example, make use of statues, make use of pictures of family members hang on the wall, that very much make a strategic use of such symbols and visual objects in order to call to mind the heritage. The third category of factors refers to emotion solicitation. Emotion solicitation means creating events that foster social emotional attachment to the heritage and to the tradition. For example, one of the companies I mentioned that before, they organize every year the same family or villa, and they have during these holidays some specific routines and activities that allow this family to really, celebrate the past accomplishment, to really, remember and keep vivid their family's past, the family's tradition into the minds of all the members, the components of the family and those of some non-family members. And finally, the fourth category of practices is what I call legacy councils. Here I'm referring more to the establishment of working governing bodies that preserve and convey the heritage across generations. For example, some of these companies have a family council. The family council is one of the governing bodies of a family firm, besides the board of directors and besides the top management team, and is the board that should be gathering all the family members dedicated to protect the interest of the family. And if you look at the family council, many of these companies that do ITT use it as, again, an opportunity to convey the heritage across generations. So they meet up and they celebrate the past accomplishments done by previous, ancestors, predecessors. They meet up and they celebrate what the family has been doing in the past, what their history has been done. So, in a way, what I'm trying to say is that behind an ITT strategy, there are a number of practices that can be put in place in order to make this ITT strategy happen. This is the most recent example of innovation to tradition in this study called Managing the Traditional Innovation Paradox in Family Firms, a Family Imprinting Perspective, published in Entrepreneurship Theory and Practice, which is one of the leading journals in the entrepreneurship field. We don't have the time to go in detail through it, but again, what we find here, studying especially small and medium enterprises, is that again, innovation to tradition is possible, and we go a little bit more in depth in understanding how they do that. Again, this paper will be made available by myself for those of you who might be interested. So let me briefly outline some conclusion before we finish our journey. Of course, I offered only a small insight into a quite complex area, but I hope that my brief presentation, it was clear that the family business setting is a unique setting in terms of governance for making decisions, specifically for making decisions about innovation. So there are unique challenges in innovation in the family business setting, and the ability and willingness paradox in family firm innovation that I mentioned before is, a typical paradox that sometimes prevents a family firm from exploiting or unlocking its innovation potential. The second important thing is that, of course, innovation is important for any business, including family business. And so family business leaders, executives, and owners should be, very much looking forward to continuously innovate across generation. But innovating, and this is important, especially for the next generation to convince the senior generation to innovate, innovation does not necessarily mean dismissing the past, because you can still innovate by instead leveraging on the past, if you are able to do innovation through tradition. And so innovation through tradition can be particularly powerful as a strategy to unlock the innovation potential of family firms, because if you are able to realize it, then you will be able to realize innovation because you will be able to overcome a typical resistance that there is in the family business setting in relation to innovation, because very often the senior generation stands to protect, to preserve what has been built, what has been created so far, and are always more reluctant to change. But with ITT, you know, you have a powerful way to show that the past and the future are not two opposing concepts, rather they can mutually reinforce each other. So the relationship between the past and the future, between tradition and innovation, can be instead symbiotic, which is exactly what we show in our most recent report. So this means that there is a lot of potential in this what emerging field. This is a new field of knowledge, a new stream of knowledge, and there is a lot of potential in research, education, and practice. And of course, we at the Center for Family Business Management of the Free University of Bonn and Bolzano are very happy to engage with our stakeholders, both in the research community and in the community of practice, to help family firms and their families to be better managed in their challenges. So I thank you very much for your attention. Here in these slides, you find my social media contacts. For those of you who would like to get in touch, and here I've reported the Dropbox link that you can access in order to download the studies that I've been mentioning during my presentation, and even some further studies I did on this topic. And this is the lovely photo of the UniBZ Family Business Center team, which is located at the Neutech Park. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you enjoyed this lecture, and I hope to get in touch with some of you soon. Bye.